Waves 2, quite well named, I think you'll agree. I think you might remember these semicircular prisms from light. It's the idea that light refracts away from the normal as it goes to a less dense medium. The glass block is given as the D-shaped thing. It's a semicircular glass block. And the yellow light is in the air. So it's refracting away from the normal. And as it gets a bigger angle of incidence, the yellow light, the emergent ray, gets closer to the surface of the block until eventually you get to a certain point where the light shines along the surface of the block. So that if you go to a bigger angle, notice that number 3 is smaller than number 4, number 4 is much bigger, you get total internal reflection. Now the point that that angle, the angle that that starts at, is called the critical angle. So before the critical angle, you have refraction. After it, you have total internal reflection. And this is how a fiber optic works, your fiber optic cables. These fiber optic cables are long, thin, transparent rods made of glass or plastic. And the idea, basically, is that you send a signal down it and it bounces off the walls rather than leaks out. It's very much better than a magnetic signal or electromagnetic signal because you can't get so much interference. Doesn't produce electric signals outside and there's not so much losses. You coat the material in a low refractive index. That means you get a better total internal reflection. Okay, and the light can't leak out. That's another reason. So, how do you use it? Well, you can use it in endoscopes, look inside the body. You can use them in periscopes because they don't use mirrors in submarines because they rot. I must say, the eyes on that guy, I could have drawn that better. Anyway, they also use them in binoculars, which is why binoculars are heavier than telescopes, because they bend the light round so that you get the same optical distance as a telescope, but in a shorter object, which is easier to put in your pocket. So all this is total internal reflection, which we've done before. But sound, also a wave, can also be refracted, can also be internally reflected. Waves behave in the same way. That's the basic point of the whole thing. An ultrasound is done in exactly the same way we were just looking at total internal reflection. You see, you take your ultrasound generator and you fire a beam of ultrasound. Now, every place where the density of the medium changes, you get internal reflection. That's a form of internal reflection, not total internal reflection like in light, partial internal reflection. Anyone seen the light experiment will remember that in the semicircular block, you get some light reflected even before it's all reflected. And this is what's happening now, partial internal reflection. And by just comparing the size of these waves using Doppler and other things to combine them with the original, you can build up a picture of what's going on inside the body using this very, very high frequency sound over 20,000 hertz, which no one can hear. That's why it's called ultrasound, just means no one can hear it. So you put the ultrasound up against the stomach, you fire the ultrasound in, and at the barriers, as the liquids change to solids, you can see the reflection. So it's a type, it's just another wave formula. So you can have a go at that. I'm just going to go silent for a moment. How far did you get? Anyway, ultrasound waves are partly reflected at the boundary as they pass from one medium to another. The time taken for these reflections can be used to measure the depth of the reflecting surface, and this information used build up a picture of the object. That's right. God, I hope you had a go at that and didn't just stand there and staring at the screen or keep tapping it to wonder where the sound had gone. Anyway, other uses of ultrasound include echo sounding, they are finding where the bottom is, finding where the submarines are, breaking kidney stones, firing, that's a kidney stone, firing sound into a kidney, shakes the kidney stones to pieces, cleaning things, teeth, watches, teeth if you're an obsessed American, watches if you're just, you know, live in the 19th century and you want a wind-up watch. Now, they were sound. We are now talking about electromagnetics again. Remember that A sound wave is a longitudinal wave. It's a different type of wave to an electromagnetic wave. An electromagnetic wave is the same sort of wave with different lengths. So what have we got? Well, we've got different waves from gamma all the way over to radio waves. And the difference is the frequency. You see, something like a gamma wave will have a very high frequency. Slightly lower frequency will be X-rays, slightly lower ultraviolet, visible infrared. And the lowest frequency waves are radio and TV waves. Now, the opposite, of course, is wavelength. Very short wavelength is high frequency. This goes back to that formula I was talking about at the beginning. C equals F lambda, i.e. the speed of a wave is its frequency times its wavelength. Now, all of these waves have the same speed. Because they have the same speed, if their frequency goes up, their wavelength must go down so that they multiply together and give you the same number. This is an inverse relationship. So, very high frequency, short wavelengths are dangerous. They carry a lot of energy per piece of wave, per photon. Whereas low frequency, long wavelengths are not so dangerous. And then you say, well, microwaves are down the bottom there. They're very dangerous. I know they are. The danger of microwaves is that they make the water in your body resonate. And so they can cook you. Other than that, really, they're not dangerous. They're not dangerous in the same way as an X-ray is dangerous. It's a completely different type of dangerous between getting cancer and boiling to death. So each type travels at the same speed through a vacuum and can be polarized. Remember that? The idea they could be polarized, that's what tells a transverse from a longitudinal, and these are all transverse waves. Different wavelengths are absorbed by different surfaces, and this is why you get different colors and different abilities to heat up because of the different things. Now, the most important thing is the higher the frequency of the wave, the greater its energy. This makes X-rays more dangerous than radio waves. So how do we detect them? Well, it depends on which wave. Infrared can be detected simply by painting the little bulb at the bottom of a thermometer black. If you've got two thermometers, one painted black and the other one isn't, you notice if the black one is showing a higher temperature, it means it's receiving infrared radiation. Radiation at a just slightly longer wavelength than light. Of course, you can also use night vision cameras. Here are some penguins huddled together. Oh, it's quite a nice picture, actually, of penguins. And that's the night vision camera you can see on the left. This is another way of detecting infrared. It's what the police use for tracking people when they're running away with fields. You know, police helicopter action. Do they still show that? And then there's UV. How do you detect UV? Well, the easiest way to detect UV is to wash your shirt in any sort of commercial powder, because it contains a chemical called an optical whitener. Now, if you wash it in this, light hitting your shirt, which is in the UV range, will be converted into white light. So your shirt looks really white. And also, when you walk into a disco and they're showing UV lights, your clothes all glow. Oh, it's so much fun. So much fun. Actually, Vaseline does as well. I don't know why I put that in. Why I associate clubs with Vaseline? I don't know. Anyway, gamma waves. Now, something like this, something with a very, very high energy, you can only really detect in something called a bubble chamber. This is where you pressurize a gas to just the right pressure or a liquid. And as the trail, as the particle or wave passes through the chamber, it creates bubbles or cloud. In a cloud chamber, it creates little bits of cloud. It's the same as a vapor trail. When you look up and you see a plane flying across the sky, it's the same principle. Because the pressure has changed behind the particle as it moves through, you get a trace of that as things come in and out of solution or bubbles are formed. In this case, it's a bubble. Microwaves. That's a microwave. They basically excite water molecules in the surface of the food, which is how it heats up. Whereas infrared is absorbed again at the surface, but by everything, all the material in infrared. This is an infrared oven. In the States, these are really popular. They don't get as dirty, and they're actually slightly more energy efficient. We've never really had them here. Don't know why. It's just one of these technologies that's never made the pond. But Microwaves we're very used to, but they are heating up the water in something by making it vibrate because they are the right length. They are not dangerous in terms of their radiation. They are dangerous in terms of the fact they give us nasty heatings. Whereas infrared will heat everything up because it's basically heat energy. And again, the higher the frequency, the greater the energy. So infrared has more energy than microwaves. Of course, when you really get dangerous, you go to x-rays. And again, I've done you a couple of closed tests here and the words are at the bottom. Why don't you stop it now and try and fill them in? They're actually quite fun. Stop. Okay, start again. Why is the sun yellow? Well, it's not. The sun is not yellow, it's actually white. Of course it's white, it's producing all the colours of light, and all the colours of light mixed together and make white. You knew that. Why did you think the sun was yellow? Why, you look at the sky and see it's yellow, you think that's it? Is that the level of physics I can expect from you? I want more than this. The sun is not yellow. Why does it appear yellow? Well, as light shines from the sun, it hits what we call the atmosphere. That's the air all around us that keeps us alive. And the blue end, blue and green particularly, get absorbed by the air molecules. So we only end up with the yellow, the red, and a little bit of the green. The blue has all been scattered. So when it hits our eye, what we can mostly see is the yellow. And that's why the sun appears yellow, because it's the strongest colour left when they've taken out all the blue. What happens to the blue, of course, is the blue gets scattered. Now, at night, as the sun sets, you see a lovely slow sunset there? It was quite pleasant. You want to see that again? Yeah. Oh, look at that beautiful sunset with its own spectrum. There it goes. As it sets, it's got to look how far. It's got to travel through more air. It's got further to go through the air before it reaches our eyes. And that means the green and the yellow gets absorbed as well. And all that's left is the red. So the red sun sets because all the blue and the green and the yellow are absorbed by the air between us and the sun. Now, of course, distance-wise, it doesn't make much difference. What's making the difference is how far that light has travelled through the air of our atmosphere to get to us. And that's why a sunset appears red. And the blue, which I started to say and then forgot was a different section, that gets scattered. So it gets scattered and appears to be coming from over here, over there, up there, because it appears to be coming from the sky. So the sky appears blue because it's the blue light which doesn't get past the air, gets scattered, and appears to be coming from every part of the sky. It's the blue light which has been taken out of the sun so the sun can appear yellow, makes the sky appear blue. Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. Sky appears blue as blue light scattered. Yeah, I've just written it down the bottom. That's really good. Who's that? Well, that's Mr. Tyndall. He was one of the guys who came up with this idea. Okay, now, last thing today is interference. Interference is the idea that two waves, when you mix them together, form a third wave, a resultant wave, a wave which is a combination of the two. Now, anyone who plays guitar will know this already. Because when you're trying to play guitar, you compare two notes and you listen. And if you can hear a rising and falling tone and volume, that's called beats, then you say, oh, I'm almost there. And when you can't hear it again, you think, oh, I must be in tune. This is interference. Now, in order for waves to interfere, they have to be coherent. They have to have the same frequency. They have to be in phase. There's two waves. They are coherent. They are in phase. The peak meets the peak, the trough meets the trough, and they have the same frequency. Okay? Now, that's actually also a coherent wave. It's 180 degrees, we say, out of phase. And that one, slightly different again. But they're all coherent, they have the same frequency, and they will move off together. They're in phase because there is a constant phase difference. One doesn't move faster, past, or across the other one. So the phase difference measured in degrees of a circle. So, for instance, number 2 and number 3 are 180 degrees out of phase, if you can imagine that. But what's important is that they move off together, that they move as one. That's the important factor. There's no change in the distance, and that makes them coherent. So we say they have the same frequency and they're in phase. Now, when two waves have the same frequency or in phase, they can interfere with each other. This is where you take two waves and you add them together and you form a different wave. This is called constructive interference because you're making a bigger wave. But interference itself is where two coherent waves meet and the result is a new wave, which is the algebraic sum of the two waves at any point. Which means if it's plus and plus, you get a bigger plus. And if it's a plus and a minus, they partially or completely cancel out. That's what they mean by the algebraic sum. We use pluses and minuses. That's what algebraic means. So this is constructive interference. And if we're going to minus, then we have destructive interference. We get a smaller wave. We subtract them. This is called, well, that wasn't impressive. That was destructive interference. And here we have it in a slightly easier to understand. This destructive interference is perfect destructive interference, which hardly ever happens. But you can have constructive interference when you get a bigger wave and destructive interference where you can completely destroy the wave. Here's some beautiful bits of interference. This is interference in soap bubbles. Because this soap bubble has many different thicknesses, each thickness has a different type of interference. So the colour, a different colour comes into your eye from that part of interference. So this is interference in a soap bubble because of the different sizes. Notice at the top, you have a dark black layer. That's because there's no interference because it's very thick. This is interference again. Anyone know what this is? No? No? There, it's a beetle. This is called the jeweled beetle. It doesn't actually have any pigment. It has tiny, tiny little holes in its shell. And the light causes the light to interfere because it's a shiny shell. So the interference and the difference in the size of the little holes cause the beetle to look coloured, even though it isn't. So by producing the right type of skeleton, it doesn't have to produce any pigment. It's giving it an advantage in terms of energy, saving a lot of energy in terms of coloration. These are diffraction holes. This is interference and dispersion at the same time. We'll be talking about this later. Basically, it's white light shining through tiny little holes. This you probably won't recognise anymore. It's a CD, in case anyone knows what one of those is. And again, you can see the light is being dispersed into its spectrum by a form of interference. And here again are soap bubbles. I just like this picture. Let's see. That's the beginning and the end of it. So that's interference. Now, next time we're going to talk about diffraction and we're going to push much deeper into the subject. Okay, question. And this is the question. That's quite a long time ago, but it's a very good question. It's a very difficult question. Some of you might try some of the pieces and then the last piece you might need to look up. But have a go at it first. See if you can think why. More I'm interested here is why this answer comes up rather than you being able to do it yourself. If you can understand the explanation, you're fine. If you can't, then you really have to ask me.